So welcome to our next talk about App Ammo. So please give a warm applause to Christian Bolz.
So welcome everybody. I'm Christian Bolz. I'm working on App Ammo upstream, mostly on the tools, and I'm also the package maintainer in OpenSUSE. So what does App Ammo do? The answer is quite simple. It allows applications to do only what they are supposed to do and denies everything else. But it isn't that easy because first it must know what is allowed. So why should you use App Ammo? Well, in a perfect world, you have bug-free and secure software, but you probably know that you won't find that software out there, because programmers can perform magic. And so you better keep an eye on what we are doing. And App Ammo will monitor the applications on the kernel level. So let's continue with my infamous bank robbery slide. Hands up, please. Who is using App Ammo? Okay, there are quite some people. Who of you already created or updated a profile with the AA something tools? Okay, that are less hands. Who edited a profile with VI or another editor? Oh, even more? Okay. And cross-check, who did not use App Ammo yet? Okay. So let's start as usual, hello world. You never can avoid that. So that's a little bash script, and I'll create a profile for it. So to create a profile, you first need to run a genprof, name of the script. So that's the first thing you do. Then, okay, let me check. Okay, then run the script. So you see it prints hello world, not surprising. And then back to the AA genprof. So you press S for scan the log. And now it shows execute cat. So you have different options how to execute it. In this case, I'll use inherit, so press I. And the same for RM. Then it obviously needs to print out hello world. So you could, in theory, allow div pts5, but that's dependent on the console you use it. So instead, you choose the console abstraction, which allows div pts everything and div tti and so on. So everything around printing on consoles. Press R to allow it. Then, of course, it needs write access to its temp file. Also allow. And when done, you can just save the changes by pressing S. And finally, F for finish. So how does the profile look now? It's quite simple. So the first one is tunables global. That are some variables you need in basically every profile. So it's always there. Then the base abstractions. It uses bash, so there's an abstraction for files related to bash. The console abstraction we added, so it of course needs to run bash. It reads the script itself, reads and writes the temp file, and executes cat and rm. Okay, so far so good, so we have our profile. Back to the slides. We have a little problem if there's a hacker around, because that script has a security bug. Does anyone know what the bug is? Okay. I think just shout it out, I'll repeat it.
There is
okay, that's the microphone. Good.
A it's possible to rewrite hello.txt before it's cat?
No, that's not the main problem.
No, but you can create a symlink in DMP.
Yes, exactly. So let's go back and just play Hacker. So I'll show you the script I'm using to avoid typing. It's just creating a symlink. So yes, you see, it's meant to replace a file you probably still need. So okay, let's create that symlink. You see, here's it. And then run the script again. Permission denied. So let me just repeat as root. And right, yes, the script deletes the symlink, so I have to recreate it. So first recreate the symlink and then run again. Exactly. So you see permission denied. And then cat says that file doesn't exist because actually I don't have authorized keys for root. But you get the point. So in other words, Abamor just prevented your first exploit. So what does Abamor do? It monitors and restricts file access, network, capabilities like change own, setuid, and you can get a full list in main 7 capabilities. You can set a limit, RKU limit, and in general restrict permissions. Counter question, what does Abamor not do? It doesn't replace the traditional file permissions, so please do not change mod 777 everything. It also doesn't replace user permissions, so you shouldn't run everything as root. And when it comes to web servers, then you should do the usual stuff like having a MySQL user for each hosting and task, validate user input, escape input. You might also want to use the Suhosin extension for PHP or avoid PHP applications at all, maybe. Or some of them. My general rule of thumb, Google for application name and exploit, and if you have more than 100,000 hits, you should avoid it. So that leads to the question, is the server secure now? Well, it depends. Security is always like a puzzle with lots of small parts, and Abamor protects you from lots of things, but not everything. So the server is more secure, but you can't say it's perfectly secure now, except if you make your profiles very strict and then it's limited to overriding things that it can write anyway. But at least it gives you additional security and makes sure it only destroys its own things, if it destroys something. So let's come to the Abamor tools. There's AA status, which shows you an overview of loaded profiles and which running programs use them. AA unconfined is something similar. It gives an overview of applications that are protected or confined. So confined means protected by an Abamor profile. And it also shows things that are not confined. AA Notify can give you desktop notifications or can be used to create log summaries. Then we have the set of tools to switch profile flags. That means AA Complain switches profiles to complain mode. That is a learning mode which allows everything and logs what would be denied. AA Enforce is the opposite. That means the profiles denies everything that is not allowed and look what is denied. We have AA disable to completely disable a profile. And we have AA audit, which means to set or remove the audit flag on a profile so everything is locked even if the profile allows it. So the next set of tools are those to create and update profiles. AA logprof is used to update profiles. AHNProf creates a new profile. We've already seen it for the Hello World. AA Autodep is a tool to create a very basic profile, but usually you want to use AHNProf instead. That's easier than reading the log and doing everything else manually. And AA EasyProf is a template-based system, which I think Ubuntu uses it. Then we have some more tools like AA MergerProf. So if you have three servers and want to have the profile updated everywhere, you can use AA MergerProf to make one profile out of two slightly different ones. AA CleanProf makes the profile more readable and removes superfluous rules because, let's say, they are covered by an abstraction. Then if you read the log, you might hit a case where you see instead of a file name just a long cryptic string. That's when you need AA decode, because that translates those encoded file names to something readable. And we have AA exec if you want to execute a binary with a different profile. So let's have a look at our AA unconfined. That's its output, and you see the first three are in enforce mode, so everything like it should be. AmaVSD is in complain mode. That means it has a profile, it writes to the log, but it doesn't deny anything yet. It's still in learning mode. And finally, we have the VSFTP daemon, you see, not confined. And it's time to fix this because a general rule is everything that is listening on the internet should have a profile. So let's just create one. So, okay. Yeah. Okay. So start creating a profile, then okay, so it's started. And let's scan the logs. You see it obviously needs network access, so allow it. Then it needs network access. You see init 6 stream. Oh, sorry, wait. Wrong window probably. Yes. So here we are. Okay. So it needs access to the network. So the question is now, do we allow just network init 6 stream? Or do we also include the name service abstraction, which includes it? So for now, let's use the more strict variant. It needs to read its own config file, surprise. So far, just save the changes, but don't finish yet. And now we'll go back and just do something like that. Okay, I think it can't read the input file, but let's ignore that for now and just see what the profile misses. That's quite something. So it needs to write to the outdid log. It's a login, so you want that, allow it. Then it obviously needs setgit and set UID capabilities so that it works as the user and not as root. So also allow it. FTP daemons to change root. So next one, you want the abstraction here for the authentication. Then also allow it. FTP users. And now you see it needs an S-switch-conf, so it's probably a good idea to allow the whole name service stack. shells, and that's it. Save the profile, finish, and let's have a look at it. So here we are. You see the abstractions we added, the capabilities, and you also see in VI, audit write is in red because it's a more dangerous capability. And also you see here a bit of color. So for VI, there's a file that supports the file highlighting. So, okay, back to the presentation. So short, what I did is when you create a profile, you need 2x terms. In the first one, start AA GenProf. And in the second one, just use your application. And the general tactics is first, when you profile a daemon, just start and stop it. That will already give you lots of log events. Create a profile with them as a start. That keeps the log small. Then use the application and then update the profile again. And when you are finished, you might want to use AA complain to keep the profile in learning mode for some time, because, I mean, FTP daemons are quite easy, but for more complex applications, you will not get everything in 10 minutes. Therefore, it's a better idea to have complain mode instead of being annoyed every 2 minutes, because, well, there's one rule missing again. So you can just do one AA log prof run an hour later or so. Okay, right. Yes. So there are different file permissions, read, write, obviously. There's a different permission for append, which you should use for log files. L is for link permissions, K for file logs, M for MAP for loading libraries or so. And there are various execute modes. Those are the IX for inherit, which I already showed. That means the program will run with the same profile. That's useful for helper applications and shells like cat, grep, RM, bash, whatever. And you can also use it for role-based access style confinement. So you can say you confine the shell of a user and he's allowed a specific set of programs, but all in inherit mode, and therefore can limit him. Then there's the child execute. That's useful for when one program calls another one, but you don't want to have a standalone profile, so that if foo is called by bar, you don't want to have a profile that is used if you call foo standalone. That's useful for helpers that need more or less permissions than the main application. So in theory, I could have used a child execute for my Hello World example for cat RM. Another option is to create a separate profile. That means it is used when the other program is called. Doesn't matter if it's called by the first one or not. And that's not a good idea for bin bash. And actually, the tools will not even allow you to create a profile for the bash, a standalone profile, because you will have an unusable system afterwards. And finally, there's the option to execute something without Abamor protection, so unconfined, or UX in the rules. And for example, you can use that to protect your SSH daemon and remove the restrictions after successful logins. So the daemon is restricted, but the users can still work without limits. And we also have fallback options, so that you can say, if a profile doesn't exist, then use inherit, or if that's the peaks. Or if a profile doesn't exist, then run the other program unconfined. Yeah, you shouldn't do that. Same for child executes with the inherit and unconfined fallback. So you always have some examples in the bottom right. And what you can also do is to name the execute target. So you can use a helper for some binaries without having to duplicate it. And the syntax is the binary you want to execute, the execute mode, px, and use the profile ping. And you can also use wildcards, so like user bin everything should use the child profile helpers. Then AA genProf and AA logProf will always ask you if you want to clean up the environment variables. In general, yes. You do not want to have things like LD preload in your environment when executing something else. And if you have a really good reason, then you can say no, but please think twice about that. So far about the file rules, which are the most important ones. So let me just give a quick overview what other rules we support. There are link rules which somehow overlap with the file rules. Then we have set a limit, so you can restrict how much CPU, memory, whatever a process can use. We have capability rules. We have network rules, but those require a patch that is not in Debian yet, and the other newer rule types are also not in Debian yet. And for details, I can recommend reading the Abamoa D5-man page. So, a short overview for the audit log. I know we are nearly out of time, yes? I think the most interesting thing is translating the timestamp. That's the date minus D at long number. And you have denied for blocked events, allowed for complaint mode, and audit for those. Okay, so the question is, I think afterwards there's the break. Can we take some more minutes or not? Okay, nobody complains. I hope that's okay. So we have mod Abamoa for Apache. Usually you put in your global configuration the AA default head name just to avoid that Abamoa proposes a head for each file. Then you can set up a head for each virtual host and also for a specific directory. So if you have a customer which uses CMS in the forum, you can split the permissions for both. What is a head? Heads are like subprofiles, and an application can switch between them. And the typical use case is Apache and a head for each virtual host.
You have time. You have plenty of time. Don't worry.
Ah, okay, good.
It's 45 minutes talk.
Okay. So then you see the syntax is also like a head. Then, how do you configure that? Number one, you want an abstraction with the usual permissions so that you don't need to do AA logProf for the very basic things. And you want to create that file with a script. So that allows like all the HTTP docs files reading, writing to the access log, and so on. Then there are some interesting things in mod Abamoa. As I said, you should create those abstractions for each V host automatically to avoid that you have to do it every time. Then there's a special head handling untrusted input, which is used when Apache is idling around. But unfortunately, it does a bit more than it should, so it usually needs write access to the logs of all virtual hosts. And it's also relevant how strict your profile is. Real world example, one of my customers had a web forum which allowed to upload avatar pictures, you know, something like myphoto.php. So you don't want that. So ideally, you just deny read and write PHP files with the owner flag. That means if Apache wants to read or write a file that is owned by the Apache user, then it's blocked. That's good against new exploits, but the problem with it is if you have a content management system which wants to download extensions or something like that, that's also blocked. So it's not too easy to use that rule. So there's also some creative usage of UpAmor. I'm using it as an inventory list, so I can see which virtual host uses a script in my shared directory, or which host is calling send mail and so sending mails. It can also be used as a debugging tool, so which files does the application read or write? And it's easier to use AHNProf to create such a summary than using strays and filtering everything out that you need. An important thing you need to know is the PS uppercase set, because that includes the profile name used by the processes. And that's especially useful if you see, oops, I have 100 Apache processes running and it's blocking everything. Who do I need to blame? And another interesting example is read-only root access for doing backups. That's a two-component solution. First, you need your SSH key, of course. And the important part here is the restriction with command root bin async shell. And in that script, I'm just logging the SSH original command, verify that it starts with async minus 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 server minus minus sender, and if it's okay, then I execute it. And of course, you need a profile for it. That's how it looks like. You see some abstractions, nothing surprising. The capability deck override and deck read search means that root is also allowed to read files who are not readable for root based on the file permissions. So if you have a file user readable only and it's not owned by root, UpAmor would deny it. And with those two capabilities, you are back to the normal behavior, like root can read everything. So yes, some execute rules, of course, and the rules to allow read access to the things you want to backup. And the most important is inherit async. So async runs with exactly this profile. So far to the part about UpAmor in general. The next question is there any relation between Debian and OpenSUSE? Well, depends on how you turn it. And now I'd like to have Ulrike here to explain some Debian-specific stuff. Yes, I think so.
Hi. I'm Ulrike. I'm here on behalf of the PKG UpAmor team in Debian. So what's the relationship between OpenSUSE and Debian? Now I'm supposed to explain that. Thank you.
Right.
So actually now Christian explained how to create UpAmor profiles, but there are already a lot of UpAmor profiles which are maintained upstream, which are used in Ubuntu, for example, and in OpenSUSE and in Debian. In Debian, we try to contribute to the upstream UpAmor profiles so that we would all share them. There are some specifics. Basically, Ubuntu has UpAmor enabled by default on their distribution, and they tend to ship the profiles which for packages in the packages themselves, which would also be the goal to do in Debian. However, today that's not yet the case, only for some packages. in Debian, if you install AppArmor and you enable it on your machine, you will get some profiles. But if you want more profiles, you either need to install the AppArmor profile extra package, which will give them to you, except for some packages which I don't know by heart, I have to admit, but maybe Intriguery knows them.
For example, in JC, we have quite a bunch of packages shipped.
Stand up, please.
So in JC, we have a bunch of packages that ship profiles confine themselves. Off the top of my head, I can mention Tor, Caps, Libvirt, Bind, MySQL, and a bunch of others.
Okay, so how do we get there? If you are a package maintainer and you want to ship an AppArmor profile which already exists, probably now it would be in AppArmor Profiles Extra, or you will create it. In the latter case, you create this profile, you should contribute it upstream. If it's already in AppArmor Profiles Extra, you can write an email to the PKG AppArmor team list and take the profile out of the extra profile package, put it into your package, and use the dev helper dhAppArmor to copy the profile where it belongs to. All this is documented on the Debian wiki under wiki.debian.org/AppArmor. Also on that wiki page, you will find instructions how to use AppArmor. If you simply want to use it, it's actually quite easy. Much easier than what you heard until now. And after that talk, we want to have a little meeting about a repository where we would share all those profiles between different Linux distributions, because for now there is an upstream repository on Launchpad under Bazaar, but we want to have a better collaboration between all the distributions and share all the profiles so that there wouldn't be so much delta in between. Yeah. Anything else somebody wants to say? Oh, and yes, we are here. So now you've seen me and Trigeri. Please go to the wiki page where you will also find instructions how to report bugs properly if you encounter them, and they are probably related to AppArmor. We've created some user tags for that. Yeah, that's pretty much it. Any questions to myself?
Okay, so doesn't seem to be the case. So I think I have one or two slides left.
Okay. Oh, yeah, so you don't need the microphone.
Okay. So if you need more information, there's the AppArmor.d main page, which explains the profile syntax. There are, of course, also main pages for all the tools and so on. There's a page in the OpenSUSE wiki, probably not too interesting for you. The Debian wiki, the AppArmor.net upstream wiki is quite interesting, and maybe you want to read the OpenSUSE security guide because it's a quite good overview if you want to get started with AppArmor. And for interactive support, you heard the Debian mailing list, the upstream mailing list is available, and of course also the chat channel AppArmor on OFTC. And if you want to see more geekos, then I would be happy to see you at the OpenSUSE conference and birthday party in next spring, probably in Nuremberg in Germany. So, any questions?
what's your vision on this cross distro profile repository? I mean, why don't you just push these profiles into the upstream source packages they belong into?
That's the theory, and probably I think the best answer I heard was I'd love to see the upstream developers care for AppAmor as much as they care for SE Linux, and then I asked, what? Well, nothing. So you see, it would be perfect, of course, but the problem is that most upstream developers of various packages just don't care, so we have to do it. And the point in the repo is also to collect all profiles in a distribution, so if they come from the AppAmor team or if they come from upstream, maybe, we want to have a place where you can look up all the profiles in a distribution, or all the distributions.
You explained how to create new profiles and to apply them, but how about the profiles which are in the distributions coming with the program and you have to change anything on it?
I don't want
to override these because they come with a package.
Yes.
I don't want to change them. Is there a way to do that correctly?
Well, there is. So the easy method is to use aalogprof. That works the same as aagenprof, except that it doesn't create a totally new profile, but it asks the same questions, so as I've shown. The problem with it is it will override the SHIP profiles. There is a way, if you do it manually, that always includes like include local profile name. So you can edit those local files, and the distribution will not touch them. And there are also plans to add support to the tools so that the tools write to those local files. But, well, you know, I don't need to tell you what a to-do list is. Okay, any more questions? Yeah.
So if you're doing a cross-distro repository, how are you going to handle distribution differences? So will this kind of... you pick if then else maybe include mess or
no? It will be a Git with branches, and the goal is to have most things in common, of course. And I didn't mention the tunable files, so you can say, for example, you have a tunable if you have different paths, or maybe you even say, well, the path if this is different, but it doesn't hurt if we allow the other one too, so we have a common profile. So one of them. So we have the option to include differences, but we want to avoid it because, you know, having lots of branches means a maintenance hell, and you don't want it. But if you are interested, just stay here after the talk. So, more questions? Okay, doesn't seem to be the case. So thank you for listening.
Thank you and enjoy the conference dinner.